about 45 million pounds of chips in a quarter. That equates to about 200 million pounds of potatoes, which is quite a few. What's interesting with M&T is they're a small town bank, and as we've grown, they've also grown with us. They've got the resources that you would need in order to go big, but they also have that friendly local community feel so that it makes it seem easier than it probably is.
Welcome to Berks County Community Television, bctv.org, to candidates' interviews for primary election 2019. My name is Jennifer Hanf, and today I am interviewing candidates who are running for Berks County Commissioner. The Board of Commissioners is an important body in our government, and I'd like to spend just a little bit of time talking about what a county commissioner's job function actually is. Our county board constitutes the chief governing body of our county. There are three elected at-large members who perform executive and legislative functions of our county government. Commissioners serve for four-year terms. Our commissioners serve on several boards. They serve on salary, prison, retirement, and election boards. They manage county finances and property. They appoint a board for assessment of real property and are responsible for the county's annual budget. They oversee the annual county tax rates and authorize our expenditures. They supervise our county's elections and provide for the care of our prisoners, maintain also our county roads and our county buildings. So I'd like to welcome tonight Mr. Jesse Royer. I am so sorry, Jesse. My mind blanked. I'd like to welcome you today to as a candidate for Berks County Commissioner and give you the opportunity to offer our viewers your background, your inspiration to run for County Commissioner, and what you can bring to the table.
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome.
Good to be here.
I got your name.
Jess Royer, yeah, that's right, there you go. Well, what drew me to the idea of running for county commissioner were a couple institutions that I wanted to see protected, and also the desire to serve. I think that service is an opportunity, also a privilege. And as you just mentioned, there are a lot of roles that make up the county commissioner position. And I think it's important to remember that all of those roles are part of the county commissioner position. It's not just one, it's not just part of it. You need to do a lot. You need to wear a lot of different hats. And like I said, I think service is both an opportunity and a privilege. And I think the desire to become a county commissioner is the same desire that led me to become a librarian. Currently, I'm a librarian at the Reading Public Library. And that is a position about which I'm very passionate. And it's also a very gratifying position. I know that when somebody comes to me at the library, I'm able to help them figure out what they need to do or where they're looking to go and help them get to that point. And like I said, it's always very gratifying to help somebody through that process, regardless of what they're working on, whether it's accessing their email or applying for a job or working through Social Security. There are a lot of different problems that people bring to the reference desk that it feels good to help them work through. And that desire to serve is the same desire that led me to run for county commissioner. And as I mentioned a moment ago, the institutions that the county has, I think, need a champion and need to be protected. And the possible sale of Berksheim and the possible sale of Berks County Prison are what really spurred me to run. I think both of those institutions absolutely need to remain in county hands. And the very notion that we would consider selling them is something that I wanted to counter. I wanted to be able to champion those institutions and also the workers that work there. Mm-hmm. As a librarian at the Reading Public Library, I'm actually a city employee and I am in AFSCME. I'm a union member and I'm a union leader within our local. And I think it's important to recognize the workers who actually make up our city and our county and our public institutions, and not use them as part of the blame for why a institution is running so well. And we should reward them for that and not say, well, it's on their backs to actually try and keep this institution open. And we saw it most recently with Berksheim, where the unions who run Berksheim and who do a very good job of doing that were actually sort of being the ones who were forced to make some concessions and actually keep it open. And that, to me, is one thing that needs to be changed. I think that the county needs to recognize its workers a little bit more and celebrate them rather than use them as a punching bag, if you will. Mm-hmm. And beyond that, my wife and I are raising our three children here in Berks County, and we love it here. We don't plan on moving again. I grew up about a half hour outside of Reading. And a little bit over 10 years ago, when my wife and I decided to get married, we actually came into the city to get our marriage certificate. We didn't know we were going to end up living in the area at the time. Mm-hmm. That was before we went on to grad school and before we had a few more adventures. But now we're back, and we have a little bit of a hobby farm out in Spring Township. And we both work in the city, and I work for the library. I love coming into the city and being a part of the city life here, but going home to a slower pace of life where we've got our chickens and our sheep and our goat, and we are able to sort of get the best of both worlds, where we have all of the offerings that come with the city, even a smaller city like Reading, where we've got cultural opportunities and we've got things that we want to do and jobs that are family sustaining that we really enjoy and feel good about. Feel good that we're helping other people do things that are important to them as well. But we get to go home to our own space, and we've got a good sized yard, and we've got a little creek in our backyard, and it's very ideal for us and where we want to be right now. But at the same time, we want to make sure that Berks County is the county that we want it to be. And that whole package is what really got me into running, that I wanted to defend certain Berks County institutions and champion them, but also make sure that the county itself is going the direction that we want it to. So that's what kind of got me into running.
Thank you very much. Yeah. You're very passionate about that. I appreciate that. The first question I'm going to do is, I took the very last part of the job description of county commissioners and kind of rolled that into a question. So I'll read that to you now. It's the goal of the county commissioners to ensure public access to information in simple and understandable formats, to oversee the county's technology, and to develop stronger working relationships with local governments and municipalities. So I want you to sort of address that last part of the job description and how you envision accomplishing that.
Well, like you said, it's important that the county makes information available and accessible to as many people as possible. And with respect to working with local municipalities, whether they're townships or boroughs, I think it is important that the county play something of a guiding role without being too heavy-handed with the way it tries to deal with local municipalities. But it does set the direction, and we see the opportunity for that in different areas. When you look at the northern part of the county, we see a lot of warehouses coming in along 78. Mm-hmm. And that is, to some people, a local issue. That is up to the local zoning and the local planning commissions and the local townships, boroughs that might approve or deny whether or not a new warehouse is going to go. What I'd like to see is a county that is actually thinking well into the future about how best to deal with that issue. And we see a lot of truck traffic that comes into areas that weren't designed mm-hmm. for trucks. Mm-hmm. We see the environmental impact of impervious surfaces, whether it's the roof itself of the warehouse or the large parking lots that go along with it. And that kind of issue is very multifaceted, and one that the county could play a role in deciding, you know what, let's try and slow down on that a little bit. Mm-hmm. That's one issue where I'd like to see the county work with local municipalities, local townships, local boroughs to sort of set a direction and provide an overarching vision that we maybe haven't really been using recently. As far as making information available, I think it's important that counties also work literally directly with local citizens and voters. Mm-hmm. I think it's important that regular people are able to see what the county government is doing and go to those county meetings whenever possible. It's difficult right now because county meetings are held at 10 a.m. on a Thursday morning. Mm-hmm. And typically, I'm working on a Thursday morning. I can't go, and yet that's what my county elected officials are doing. And I'm often able to watch the rewatch on something like BCTV. Mm-hmm. But if I can't watch it live, if I can't be there to comment on it, I'm only able to see what happened. Mm-hmm. I'm not able to have a voice in its happening unless I happen to be off that day, or I take time off, or I schedule my lunch break to be at that meeting when there is a forum for public comment. So one thing I'd like to see differently is the county making itself available a little bit more to citizens by having evening meetings, by having meetings outside of that 10 a.m. time when other people could go. And even if it's a different time, different weeks out of the month where there is a designated week where this is designed for public comment, I think that the county needs to be a little bit more accessible to citizens. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I personally have felt as I've been trying to pay attention to what the county is doing.
Right.
I always have to watch it in replay or see it from a distance. I can't be there personally because of my work schedule.
Right. As most people are working, as you pointed out.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. So I'm going to move on to the idea of transparency. And transparency and how you will ensure transparency and an ability to stand up to corruption when it exists or if it exists in county government.
Right. Yeah. And the easiest way to do that is to be as open as possible. We have seen, and I in the library field, I feel this personally, the advances that the internet makes available and the way you can really digitize so much and make things available so quickly that it is really imperative on all public institutions, in my opinion, to embrace what is essentially a new technology. And by new, I mean, you know, like in the last 25 or 30 years. But we are at a point where we should be making things as open as possible, as quickly as possible. And the idea behind, you know, having a meeting at 10 a.m. and broadcasting it live and broadcasting on replay is a starting point. Mm-hmm. But I think we should be making agendas, even working agendas, as available as possible. And right now, the idea behind making an agenda and the previous minutes from the previous meeting available 24 hours prior, that kind of thing can be done a week prior. It can be done immediately. You can have a running agenda that you can update as the meeting gets closer. And of course, agenda items do change. And what actually gets discussed at the meeting might change the morning of the meeting. But being as responsive as possible is a matter of uploading a PDF. And that can be done very easily online. As far as actual transparency for the day-to-day operations of the county commissioners, and again, I see this at the library where we have certain programming or certain events that people come to us and say, you know, what are you doing and maybe why are you doing it? Mm-hmm. And we're able to say, well, this is what we're looking for and this is what patrons have asked us, and be open about why we're doing something. And with respect to the way an elected official could go about doing that, I think it's important that they remember that they do serve at the privilege of the, at the behest of the voters. Mm-hmm. And it is a privilege to serve, and that we have a duty as people in the public eye to be responsive to those voters as well. And I think that there should not be any attempt to thwart or slow down a member of the public's journey for information. And it really is a journey sometime. Mm-hmm. With respect to filing a right to know request, trying to get information about a certain proceeding is usually met with the digging in of heels and slowing that process down as much as possible. And what I would like to see is, except in the very most extenuating of circumstances, immediate delivery of the information or documents that are requested. And we saw that most recently with going back to Berksheim, the sale process for Berksheim was often clouded. And when there were certain groups asking for documents or information through right to know requests, we saw the county resisting that. And I think that does a real disservice to the community.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that answer. And as a librarian, I can see that you're very passionate about information.
Information Thank you. Wants to be free.
Equal opportunity, okay. How will you promote equal opportunity for growth and quality of life among Berks County's diverse communities, the townships, municipalities, and the city of Reading? And how will you promote accessibility equally of the services that everyone needs?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the county does have a much more diverse population than people may have realized in the mm-hmm. past 10 or 15 years. That we even saw today in the Reading Eagle, on the day that this is being filmed, that the population growth in Berks County is largely due to immigration. And it's not that we are birthing more people, it's that more people are coming to us and they want to live here. And while the birth rate is still eclipsing the death rate, you know, Berks County is growing in a couple different ways
mm-hmm.
and areas, we do see a changing demographic. And I think it's important to recognize that. And as much as possible, whether or not it's appointments to boards or, you know, hiring for county employees or working with contractors and subcontractors, I think it's important to ensure that we have actual representation mm-hmm. of the demographics of the area. And it's important to get out to job fairs and be accessible to people who might not even know that there are certain opportunities existing in the county government. Obviously, positions are posted on the website. Not everybody checks the website, and not everybody has access to the internet. Mm-hmm. And as a librarian, I see people daily who come in to use our internet because they don't have it at home. And I think it's important to be accessible online, but also be accessible in the community at job fairs, where a student at RAC can see what is available and what the county is looking to hire. With respect to signing contracts and employing subcontractors, it's also important to recognize that the largest company in the area might be able to outbid other companies in the area simply because of the depth of their pockets. And when it comes to making sure that contracts are awarded on a basis that is fair and spread around to as large a community as possible, it's important to look at the extension of a contract from the time it's signed until the time the project is completed, and watching for change orders that say this low bidder is actually going to be making several mm-hmm. changes down the road, which make this the overall cost more than some other bidder may have been able to do it. And looking at ways to actually encourage, like I said, a diverse pool of contractors and subcontractors as well.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. We did talk a little bit about Berksheim and the problems, or I should say the challenges that were faced in the last year or so. But now Berksheim has been placed in county hands for 5 years. I want to talk about the future. How will you create a permanent plan, a strategy for continuing quality care and sustainability at the Heim?
Yeah, 5 years is basically tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Berksheim has been around for almost a quarter century. And to give it 5 years on paper, I think is pretty short-sighted. I don't think we should be limiting it to that so transparently, to use a loaded term. I think we should be saying that Berksheim is in county hands indefinitely. And as I mentioned earlier, I think the workers who are at Berksheim are largely responsible for how well it's being run. And when you go there and you see the care that the patients are getting, you see that it's not just a job for the people who work there, mm-hmm. that they are passionate about it, that they do care about it, and they do care about the residents who are there. And with respect to the future for Berksheim, it's important to remember that where we are is not guaranteed, and where we were 30 years ago is different from where we are now. The Heim has developed, and as always, it's a living institution, but the Heim has developed recently into a very well-run facility, and that's largely due to the efforts of the people who work there. And we need to, again, reward them for that by not attacking their contracts and not asking them to negotiate contracts early. And we need to make sure that it has a place indefinitely. And with respect to labor practices, it's not practical to sign a 99-year contract. That's just not how these mm-hmm. things typically work. But we shouldn't be saying it's good for 5 years. We'll cross this bridge mm-hmm. when we get to it again in 5 years.
And it might be even, you know, talk about the economic issue. You know, how are we going to economically continue to care for our aging population? Mm-hmm. What kinds of plans do we have to put in place strategically to make sure that we can continue that care?
Yeah. One of the really heartening things about the recent attempt to sell Berksheim, or the exploration of the sale of Berksheim, was the outpouring of support from the community. We saw a lot of groups, we saw a lot of individuals come forward to say, this is important to me. And one thing that has been pointed out is also that the state is paying a little bit more attention now to reimbursement rates. And it's important mm-hmm. to continue to work with the state and, you know, elected officials in Harrisburg in order to show that this is an issue that is costing us more and more each year. And if you're not going to raise the rates, that's going to hurt the patients in the long run, the residents in the long run. And where we are now and where we are moving forward, it's important to address issues as they come up. And we saw a 10-year projection that showed a potential deficit of $18 million. It also showed a potential deficit for 2019, which has not come to fruition, which is a good thing. We have not seen the deficit that we are looking at as something we might have to deal with right now. But it's also important to remember that a projection is just a projection. It's a best guess. It's a way of looking at the numbers and saying this might be where we end up. And it's important not to be scared by a projection. Now, I think that the upside of the projection of a potential loss 10 years down the road was that it did mobilize a lot of people, and there's value there. Mm-hmm. But I think it's also important to remember that this is something that we have to deal with, and that it's something that we have to address without going all the way towards the other side of well, let's sell it and let's get mm-hmm. rid of it. It's something to actually try and work through.
It's a matter of management.
Instead of trying to be afraid of it and scared and just say we should unload this institution.
Great. Thank you very much for that answer. We have time to go on to the Berks County Prison, another big, important institution here in our county. There's been discussion of the pros and cons of privatizing the prison, and you've stated your views. I want to talk about the economics of that then. I want to talk about with a public prison, which is owned by the county, we are looking at rebuilding a jail. And I want you to just address a little bit about your vision and your thoughts about the nuts and bolts about how we'll go forward with the prison mm-hmm. in the future.
Yeah, Berksheim is a little bit more of a feel-good institution. We want to support Berksheim because of the people who are there are our family members. Berks County Prison is something that people are a little bit more willing to say, well, that's a different situation. And I don't necessarily agree with that. I think it also is also an institution that absolutely needs to remain in county hands. I think that we have an obligation to actually serve the population that's in the prison. And I mean serve them in the sense that we're not going to privatize the prison and incentivize prisoners. I think it's important to keep the county-owned prison a county-owned prison because we essentially put the prisoners in that jail. And we have a responsibility to see through their sentences and their terms there and their stays there to the point where we are able to say, okay, you've done your time. We need to make sure that you are actually reintegrated into society. And in private prisons, that's not usually the approach that's taken. In private prisons, what we see is the incentivization of criminals. And you want to see people stay in there because you have a minimum occupancy rate guaranteed. Or you want to see people stay in there because it's actually making the prison money. And recidivism rates and reentry rates are directly correlated to privatized prisons. And the idea behind privatizing a prison is very similar and at the same time a little bit different from privatizing a nursing home. Both institutions, I think, need to remain in county hands because we have other private nursing homes and we have a duty to keep prisoners in a public-owned prison. And neither of those are going to be served by private owners and private operators.
How do you feel moving forward on the rebuild of the jail structure itself? I mean, how do you think we should proceed with that?
Yeah, I mean, obviously from an infrastructure standpoint, we do need to do that. Mm-hmm. We can't keep an old building alive if it's falling apart. And I personally live in an old house. Every time you live in an old house, there's always something that needs doing. Any old building needs to be repaired. And any old building, especially where we are housing people somewhat against their will, needs to be maintained. And if we have to build a new one, that's going to be a big expense. But that doesn't mean that we should be afraid of the expense. That's something that we need to manage and deal with.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. I want to talk a little bit about, we're very close to the end, actually. So just very, very briefly, I want to talk about your vision of leadership, how you envision promoting the positive interactions that need to take place in order to make the county work. What are you bringing to this leadership role that will help make that happen?
Yeah, well, I like the way you phrase it, positive interactions. I think it is important that elected officials are accessible to voters and citizens. And I think it's also important to remember that elected officials do have an opportunity to serve, and they are serving as a privilege. It's not something that anybody has a right to. Mm-hmm. And some people want to talk about term limits. At the same time, elections serve as a term limit, and it gives us a chance to sort of hold our elected officials accountable. And once you're in that office, you need to remember that you're there because people voted for you and that they actually want you there. And when you're working as an elected official, it's important to be accessible and to be visible and to be approachable so that somebody who says, you know, I don't know who my county commissioner is, has the opportunity to meet you as much as possible. And it has the opportunity to feel valued by you as well. And I believe in leaders who are servants to the population. I believe in a leader who is able to say, you know, this is what I've heard and this is what people have come to me with. And I think it's important to remember that you are answerable to the population.
Great. And now we've come to a time where I'd like you to wrap things up for the viewers and give us just a brief minute about why you should be elected, asking your voters to vote for you.
Well, I think Berks County has a lot of potential. I think Berks County is at a bit of a crossroads here in 19. It's important to remember that where we have come from is important, but where we are going is as, or in some cases, more important. We have a changing population, and it's important to remember that as we move forward and adapt to that as we move forward. And my personal vision for Berks County, which is not mine alone, I know this is shared by a lot of people with whom I've spoken recently, and people who lived here their whole lives. They want to see Berks County be welcoming, and they want to see Berks County be available to as many people as possible, whether it's a place to raise a family or a place to grow old or both. That's what we are looking to do, my wife and I. We want to raise our family and spend the rest of our lives here. And it's important to make the county as accessible to as many people as possible.
Thank you. And thank you, viewers, for tuning in to this important collection of discussions that we've had on County Commissioner. And please remember to vote on Tuesday, May 21st, in the primary election. The polls will be open from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. in the evening. Thanks.
We make about 45 million pounds of chips in a quarter. That equates to about 200 million pounds of potatoes, which is quite a few. What's interesting with M&T is they're a small town bank, and as we've grown, they've also grown with us. They've got the resources that you would need in order to go big, but they also have that friendly local community feel so that it makes it seem easier than it probably is.